What do you think?
I'm going to start up in a minute or so. So we'll just see if anybody else joins and I'll start to get us ready.
Can you hear me? Oh, wait, let me. Okay. Okay, wait, yeah. Julia, do you mind muting everybody? Is that okay? Then we can, is that cool? Okay. Can I still be, can you still hear me okay? Mm-hmm. Well, can you tell you're in the same room with me? Okay. Okay. Well, thanks everyone for coming again to present. This is our fourth Sunday in a row that we've been doing this. It was never meant as more than a one-off, but here we are, and it's more than halfway through April. Time flies. I mean, we were just told recently that here in Berlin and Germany, things may reopen on May 4th. Emily's and my stepkids might go back to school. Businesses might reopen their doors. I mean, but it's kind of a strange, bittersweet feeling. I mean, I don't even know anymore what does it mean to go back to, quote, normal. I mean, it's been such a strange time. And so the transition back to something or to whatever happens next is going to be equally odd, surprising. I mean, I keep having these dreams. I mean, for the last, I think when starting in mid-March, I started having dreams where I'd see friends of mine and they'd try to give me a hug and I would run away from them. They were these kind of terror physical distancing dreams. But more recently, I've started to have all these dreams where I have a lot of luggage and I have all these bags and I have to pack them very quickly to make some sort of train or plane or event. And I'm always just about to lose something. And, you know, there's always something that's forgotten. And so it's like, it makes me think like, what are the remnants of my past life that I'm trying to take with me into whatever comes next? I mean, last night's dream, just, I woke up this morning and I was on a train with a colleague of mine and I had all of these bags and I put them on all of these chairs. I don't know why I was taking up so much space, excuse me to everyone else. But I had an extra pair of jeans and I had put it on top of one of my bags, on top of a duffel bag. And then I came back and it was gone. And in the dream, it was really stressful because in the dream, I only had one pair of pants. But then I woke up and I realized, actually, it doesn't really matter because I only really need to wear pants on Sundays when I see all of you here. Otherwise, the rest of the time, there's no need for that. But seriously, I mean, I have the sense that whatever this next period of time is going to be, it's going to be one of learning and unlearning, of recalibrating ourselves and the things that we've taken for granted up until now to try to figure out what comes next. I mean, this question of learning and unlearning, whatever is embedded within us, without us even knowing sometimes, that is going to run through today's discussion. So today we have a fantastic program. My co-host, designer and professor Emily Smith, we'll be leading a discussion with the designers and educators Lisa Baumgarten, Pras Gunasekera, and Ramon Tejada about teaching design today. We're also going to have artist Connie Samaras, who is calling in from early morning Los Angeles. She's been on the show everyone since the first, and she's going to continue to seed the science fiction writer Octavia Butler and her work Parable of the Sower. This time we'll be reading from the book and also discussing our dreams in smaller groups. And then in between, we'll also have some short films and excerpts by artist Lee Ladair and American Artist that touch on group dynamics and teaching in the wake. And so, you know, I think that these will hopefully give us a bunch of things to discuss. Today is a little more laid back than we've done in the past, and I'm looking forward to that. But as always, if you're interested in staying in the loop about the show, you can find all of the most up-to-date information, what's happening on the show, where you can find it, whatever next week's episode is, online. Julia, can you spotlight yourself so that we can all see you? Julia, where is Julia? Okay, there's Julia. Julia is our assistant who helps produce this show from afar in Berlin-Neukölln. And Julia will also be here to help us with the inevitable technical difficulties, because if there's one thing we've learned in the last 4 weeks, it's that running large-scale Zoom meetings is bumpy. But Julia is going to also be copying things into the chat periodically if anybody is interested in delving further. And so, Julia, can you copy in the link? She's going to copy in a bit.ly link where all of the most up-to-date information on the show is there in a pretty lo-fi form. And also, if you want to get on our mailing list in some way, it's really lo-fi also. We send out one mail a week every Thursday night telling people when the show is happening and who's on it. You can email Julia as well. It's info@p-exclamation.org, all written out. She'll put that in the chat. And then we can stay in touch if you want to. But yeah, that's about all I have as an intro for now. I mean, those of you who have been here for the past weeks, you know that we have some rituals. We always kind of start with counting to 60. It's something that I myself have done for a while. And but I wanted to kind of, as a tool, it's a tool to focus myself and to bring my body and mind in alignment. But today I wanted to pull back the curtain and tell you a little story about one of my first teachers, who was my maternal grandmother, Lakshmi Subramaniam, or Lakshmi Iyer. And so when I was a kid, my grandmother, who often lived with us in our house, she taught me how to count to 1,000 and beyond using just two hands. And it's a very simple and ancient method of counting. I mean, most faiths have their own way of keeping track of numbers. This one is no more special than any of the others. It's just the way that I learned. But back then, I mean, it was a little annoying. I had to say certain prayers 1,000 times, and it would take almost an entire day, and I'd have to sit cross-legged. And as this little kid, I had no idea why I had to do this. I didn't understand the prayers, and it was boring. So, you know, it was something I did. But then a couple of years ago, I realized that there was actually something potentially valuable in this tool of counting that my grandmother had taught me. I mean, even if you strip away the manifest content of it, which is a Sanskrit prayer, as I learned it, you can still count out loud, and doing that slowly can serve itself as a kind of focusing or meditative tool. And so for today's segment, I'm gonna play you a short 4-minute and 33-second video I made last year, which was my way of trying to teach people this tool of counting. Feel free to count out loud with it at home if you like. Let's see if I can get the tech to work. That's always the fun part of these sessions. Julia, give me a thumbs up if you hear sound. How's that? I think that's a thumbs down. Damn. Okay, let's try that again. Huh. Ah, okay, let's try one more thing. See, this is always the fun part. There.
Fingers crossed.
Fingers crossed.
Hi, my name is Prem Krishnamurthy. Today, I'm here to teach you a simple form of meditation called counting. Counting is very easy to do. You can do it while you're walking, on the train, when you're at home, while you're taking a break from work. The only technology you need are your hands and your mouth. It's a way of synchronizing your body, your voice, and your mind all at once. Counting is an ancient technique, but it's even more relevant today. Anytime you have a couple of minutes and you need to relax your body, focus your mind, or calm your stress, you can use counting. First, you start with your right hand. When you're counting, every segment of your finger is a number. Think of a clock that's turning clockwise. So we can start here, thumb and forefinger, with one, then continue. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. Why don't you try that with me? You can say the number 2. It makes it even easier. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. If you have 2 hands, it means you have 2 digits. So whereas we're using the right hand for 1 through 10, we can use the left hand for 10 through 100. It's the same principle, just in reverse, going counterclockwise. And here, each finger segment represents not a single number, but the tens digit. Like this, we start with thumb and forefinger, and with 10, then we continue. 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100. Now, try it with me. Again, saying the numbers will make it easier. 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100. Let's synchronize your right and your left hand to count to 100. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And when we get to 10, we synchronize it with your left hand. 10. You hold the tens digit on your left hand and continue on your right. 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30. 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40. Are you getting the hang of it? 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, 48, 49, 50. And so on and so forth until you get to 100 and beyond. I count every day to 1,080, which might sound like a high number, but it gets easier and easier and has even more interesting results. For now though, I'd recommend that anytime you have a couple of minutes in your day and you need to relax your body, focus your mind, or calm your stress, just count to 100. Once you've done that, come back and I'll show you a couple of other ways to make counting even more useful.
Okay, thank you. So, can you hear me okay now?
Yes, you sound good.
Great.
Okay.
Okay, so for those of you who have been here before, we'll start with our other typical ritual, which is starting to read from P exclamation mark DF. This is an ongoing and somewhat quixotic, ever-changing electronic book that contains a lot of thoughts and is written in different moments in time. So let me start the screen sharing again and jump into that. Let's see. So today, all right, I wanted to read a section from inside of PDF that thinks about different models. And I'll be joined, as usual, by Emily Smith. So, is that, wait, the quality, right. We're learning all these new things. I mean, we're learning that when Zoom, when you optimize it for video, it looks like crap on graphics, and that they're lots of other things that we have to know. So hopefully this looks a little better. Yeah, cool, thanks, Emily. So this section of PDF, which is part of a chapter called Protocols, it's called Workshop of Workshops, named after a course that Emily Smith used to teach here in Berlin, still does. It's an attempt to put together, to propose a new model. And it's essentially trying to take the best and worst aspects, well, really take the best aspects of five organizational structures that I have had some experience with. A studio, in this case, a graphic design studio, gallery, school, individual psychotherapy, and the temple. And trying to look at them structurally, how can you kind of learn from all of them? And so I'm not going to read all of this because if you do have a copy of PDF, you can see it yourself. But I try to go through first my experience having started the graphic design studio Projects in New York in 2004, which then became Workshops, the graphic design studio that I currently run with Chris Wu and also Eric Price and Sarah Demuse in New York. But also goes through my early history of working at other graphic design studios, what worked and what didn't work. And in many ways, it tries to think about the scales of functioning and how each of these models has something to contribute if you can take the best aspects of them. And then it looks at gallery as a model. And of course, each of these is also very reduced. It comes from my own experience, in this case, having run an experimental gallery called P! Exclamation mark in New York for about 5 years, and how out of that I understood so much more about how the art system functioned on an economic level, but also understood what were the social structures that seemed to work. How was it that a gallery could create a cohort and create a community? What were the best aspects of it and what were the most challenging? And again, to try and learn from that. Today, I think the focus of a lot of our session is about the idea of schools. And I will admit, I have the least experience with schools, at least in terms of formal education above grade school. I only got a bachelor's degree in fine arts, and I actually, beyond that, never got a master's, never got a PhD, and did all of my schooling in the US and in Germany. And so, that's how I, in some ways, I see myself as, I don't know that. I know a bit about running a graphic design studio. I know a little bit about running a gallery. I know a lot about Temple from having gone through it, and maybe therapy as well. I know the least about school. And that's why I wanted to bring today Emily Smith to run this discussion with a bunch of people whom I think can give us a lot of insight into schools. But I'm trying to understand what are the things that work, what is the advantage of an art school, and why might it be useful? What can we learn from it? So I'm going to jump from there to another section later in P! Exclamation mark DF. Some of you who have been with us for a couple of weeks might have heard me throw around the term bumpiness. It's a way that I like to talk about the contemporary condition of where so many experiences in our world are more and more smooth. They're meant to go quickly. They help us to consume more. And I posit bumpiness as a productive friction, something that stands in the way of easy consumption, but also slows you down. And so I'll read a short section from PDF about bumpiness and then hand it over to Emily, who will continue from there. So let me test out a natural metaphor to explain my idea of bumpiness. A rock, for example, begins rough when it breaks off of a cliff face, but smooths out while tumbling down the river. Somewhere on this path from mountains to beach, it has become bumpy, no longer jagged nor sharp, yet textured enough to retain a unique shape and character. In contrast with high gloss finishes, which maintain their sealed surfaces in the face of water, oil, acid, or worse, bumpy objects are irregular and inviting. These contours pick up particles along the way. But what does this mean for curating design, art, and beyond? Sometimes it seems we're being taught that the main aspiration of curating and design, as well as art making, public speaking, cooking, parenting, or whatever else, should be to create perfect products. The idea of bumpiness rejects the notion that a sexy, smooth work is the only thing worth pursuing. In my mind, the purpose of cultural production in particular is to engage and provoke, enamor and irritate. Achieving both may require a bit of irregularity, uneven surfaces to stimulate the senses. That being said, not every piece of design or curating should be bumpy. A highway sign that's difficult to read causes accidents. A voting ballot with a confusing layout may change history for the worse. In these examples and others, our choices are fast-paced and mission-critical. Design's function has grave importance. But most cases are not so clear-cut. Many of today's choices are manufactured, with the implicit goal of making us choose more, the cornerstone of a society founded on the myth that choosing things, whether shoes or books or artworks or social media platforms or cities or lovers, equals freedom. Here's where I think bumpiness comes into play. By rendering situations reflexive, turning presentation itself transparent, design and curating might start to reveal the hidden structures driving our contemporary world. Perhaps this acknowledgement could help us develop in different directions. Even though this might involve, irony of ironies, having to make certain choices.
So I'm going to take over from here. I want to introduce these orange pages just really shortly. Prem and I wrote these actually in 2018 as a projection into the future. They're actually sort of fictional in some ways, autobiographical in others, and take place in 2023. So those of you who have not been on our journey for the last few weeks. We teach the way we were taught. I have my own long relationship to out-of-the-box pedagogy. In her late 30s, my mother helped establish an alternative school out west. I was her student, so I witnessed the experiment firsthand, for better or worse. The legacy of Black Mountain College and other experimental schools, from the Bauhaus to Deep Springs College to the Werkplatz Typographie, has followed me wherever I go. Over the past decades, I've moved between disciplines, collecting ideas and methods along the way. Coming out of a liberal arts background, I worked in the music industry, started a cultural center, a cafe, and a music festival. I choreographed, played in a band, made my first lo-fi graphics for the local art and music scene. Curious, I headed back for a design degree to learn more. I spent the years after graduating working as a corporate and exhibition designer, but purely client-driven work felt emptier and emptier. So I pursued a master's degree in visual anthropology, where I researched post-socialist communities. Almost a decade ago, in the mid-teens, I became a professor, and I developed an English language communication design program in Berlin. In some ways, I fell into the role, but it proved a testing ground for new pedagogical ideas, combining classic design methods with experimental approaches drawn from performance, design thinking, and the social sciences. I remember when the word multipotentialite was in vogue, cringe, as a way to identify people whose interests span many fields. Back then, some people called me a designer or an anthropologist or a professor. Others thought of me as an improvisational pedagogue or a creative cartographer or an exhibition maker or a score-based choreographer or a mother or a daughter or a lover. But today, I'm here as co-founder of a new institution focused on the kind of creative work that exists between accepted disciplines and established areas of study. I suppose I'm a good example of the kind of people who've come here to join us. Prem.
Thank you, Emily. Okay, so that will frame a bit of today's session, and we might pick up on different strands of it throughout our conversation. But to start, I wanted to play us a short excerpt from a film, the film The Task by the artist Lee Ladaire. This is a film that was made in 2017, and it's a film that's, it's a 2-hour film that I'll only show about 6 or 7 minutes of, but it's shot over 3 days in a Tavistock group therapy session. It involves about 30 people who are all participants in this group therapy, as well as 3 professional consultants who wield an unusual power within the room. And much of the discussion that happens over the course of this film is about the power dynamics in the room, how they unfold and what is happening there. I will say it's a deeply uncomfortable film. It's one that the first time I saw it, it gave me shivers in multiple moments. It made me feel very uncomfortable. But I think that that's also why I keep coming back to this film. I think this work of Lee's and Lee's work in general, it implicates itself in a way, it also puts itself in the position of vulnerability, as well as taking on the agency and power of a filmmaker and artist. And I think that this complexity, this lack of resolution is what gives it a lot of its interest. And so I'm gonna play a short segment here. And afterwards, Julio will also, Lee has very graciously said that we can make a link to watch the whole film available to all of you. And so Julio will share in the chat afterwards a link so that you can see the whole film if you're interested and not too freaked out by it. So give me a second to work on the tech and I'll start up this 7-minute segment of the film.
Well, the room changed.
Yeah. How has it changed?
Physically?
Well, I was invited.
I meant okay. Structural room. I don't think
it's yeah, I meant physical, yeah. Literal.
The how do you think the room changed?
Or
though?
Maybe.
Yeah.
I'm just not anxious for walking in the room.
Well, I would imagine that a dynamic changed.
Somebody else at the end of the spiral.
Somebody else, yeah, I was invited to. I wasn't going to.
You deserve it.
And somebody else is outside the spiral.
And so I wonder how this will affect the role of consultants. Is this,
I feel smaller already.
Takes them out of the loop if they're not going to speak up.
I'm reminded of a joke. The joke was a guy who had a bitch in heat, and he took her on a fox hunt, and the dogs went running, and he couldn't find the dogs, and finally someone pointed out to him, and he said, "Oh yeah, we saw the dog. The dog's running that way. The fox was running third."
Right. Yeah, I'm not sure I'm qualified to leave.
I'm glad you didn't say, "This is a really funny joke."
I'm loaded up by the story that occurred prior that this, in the second group, where they don't sit down immediately, and it becomes a point where they get to talk about how the authority gets usurped, gets evicted, how we revolt against. I can totally feel like these are not my words coming out of me. Yeah. I do believe I'm speaking for some part of the group. Speaking for myself, I'm not sure that I was elected by the entire group, and I'm also not sure how much of my will is involved in being here, or if I surrender to being this, the symbolic, and I don't want to keep talking about it.
There was an election?
You missed it.
No, he made it. He made one.
Peter, for everybody?
Pardon me?
You have something to say to everybody?
I just said that's been his plan from day one.
Wow.
Well, you know, I mean, that's just my take on it. You know, that's been his plan and my man plan to sit next to him from day one.
Okay.
You know, to drive and turn and twist the route in a direction they feel it needs to go.
Well, maybe my motivation has changed in terms of my choosing to sit here in anticipation that Mr. Lewis would sit there. As it worked out, he seated to my left. And I'm much more interested in joining rather than overtaking.
I find a lot of joy in the idea that, so I suggested, sorry, camera moving, and Brad sit there, and it was sort of a question, should I or shouldn't I? And I feel complicit in encouraging him to sit there, but I think it's also like a playfulness, trying to see what happens when we shift the power.
Is the power like or to share though?
Well, no, but it is, if it's not the metaphorical power, it's the spatial distribution.
Like, the group to consider that he is not the only white man to have changed physical position in this group.
Yeah, but the only two white males that let it be known early on. The very first group that was their plan. At least my man with the glasses, because he said he was in competition. He feel like he's competing and that he need to win and all that. That's the first thing to come up out of his mouth. So the plan was there from day one.
All of the consultants have been moved. In fact, the female consultant's been moved to farther.
And there's a new person behind you, isn't there?
Oh, my goodness,
move
the observer,
beyond
but
this.
The observer, the leader observer. The hidden power.
Because I don't consider that we have to sit somewhere. Any place you can say, well, you picked this place, but you have to pick some place, right? And if you're going to try to get to why I picked it, there's layers. I walked in,
sure.
This was empty.
Your invitation here, and excuse me, your invitation here is to understand what's going on here in front of you, how you participated in it, and what impact it has on you and your anxieties, if you have them, if you don't. your task is to try and understand how you participated in this configuration and what it means to you and how you will do your work or not.
Correct. Well, I'm going to still do my work, regardless of who's sitting in here, being here, chair. I'm going to do what I've been called to do.
But you make an important comment, that is that it was stated up front. So this is, the, you know, it was told to us. So in that sense, we played a part in it because nobody operated to say no.
I mean, you know, like what you just said, I think, you know, I think that the majority person came in just picking a chair with no hidden motive behind it.
Power motive
behind it. But my man clearly, I mean, that's the first thing to come out of his mouth, that it was his goal to make a power move.
That's a fact.
You know, so.
But he's also saying right now he thinks that it's changed. So,
yeah.
Do we believe him, or do we kind of assume
noise? Well, I give him the benefit of the doubt, but I mean, he's talking different, but still the emotions is still the same. But
reality is there.
Yeah,
I think there is. There are two chairs. One represents real power, and one symbolic power. Right?
I think.
So that chair really has no power. I mean, just a chair, right? Well, you know what the other chair is, and it's as far from the center as possible. There's no further spot from that chair that real power occupies. So how do you guys reflect on that?
I think the real power is in the group, not in the leader. It's always have been in the group, not in the leader. I mean, now the leader has his purpose.
Is there a leader?
Hypothesis is that what's going on here is
Okay. Let's see if I can get back. Okay, well, thank you. Julia will copy in to the chat the link to the entire task. And if you're interested, you're welcome to watch Lead the Dares film. So now I want to invite Emily Smith, my co-host, to once again come to the stage to introduce the fantastic group of people that she's assembled today to hear. Thank you, Emily. I'm going to pass it over to you.
Okay, thank you. Welcome. It's great to be included. I've been sort of in the background for a while, and so now I get to kind of have a little bit of the stage, which is interesting that we even call this a stage. I've got three guests that I've asked to come and join me today. We're not calling it a panel, we're sort of calling it a short discussion. And I think some of the things that I've had conversations with all three of them, I've sort of put them together in a simple way. Who teaches, who we teach to, who we teach about, how we teach, where we teach, when we teach, and why we teach. And I think with these considerations, I'd like to sort of start the conversation. So I've got Ramon Tejada, Lisa Baumgarten, if you guys want to unmute yourselves, and then we can get Julia to kind of get you on, and Pras Gunasekera. Thank you. Great. So I don't want to see me. I want to see them. I'm not interested in seeing myself, so maybe we can start. So I'm seeing Lisa really quickly right here. So
Hi, Lisa.
Welcome. So maybe I can just start with, I'm going to ask all of you guys the same question. And it's sort of, why do you teach the way you teach? And we've sort of talked about this. Maybe you can sort of highlight a little bit where you got. I should maybe introduce you really briefly. I know you from your teaching design conversations that you hosted at the A to Z Gallery.
Mm-hmm.
And Lisa also teaches at Bremen and HTW in Germany around design history and design practice, very much from an intersectional feminist perspective. And you've been doing some fascinating work asking a lot of these same questions.
But we'll come back to that. But maybe you can kind of start us off a little bit with telling us about your awakening, perhaps you might call it that.
So thanks for having me, first of all. My awakening. So I started with doing workshops after uni, and then very quickly went into teaching at universities and design schools. And what I realized was a surprise. It was very different to teach in an institutional context than doing workshops. And I observed myself teaching the way I was taught, which I didn't like at all. So I started to look for alternative ways of teaching, alternative methods of, I was looking a lot for different materials. So for example, design history or typography from a non-canonical perspective. And so because I knew that I didn't want to teach the way I was taught, and and during that time I had a very dear colleague, Anya, and we talked a lot about doing it differently and started to share materials and methods, and this is also how we started the teaching design project or platform, as you can say, because we wanted to share the material that we found, and also to make it easier for people who want to teach differently, and because we wanted to build a network, because we felt like educators on our level, like lecturers, are not really connected, they're not really talking to each other, and we were really hungry for a conversation.
Okay. That's great. We'll come back to that, because I think your bibliography and your conversations project really important. Pras, do you want to join us for a moment?
Hello.
Why do you teach the way you teach, Pras?
Again, thanks for having me also. I suppose just a bit of background, I studied architecture and then I did a master's in industrial design at Central St Martin's in London, where I'm from. And I think it was actually during that specific academic experience that I realized, A, I suppose my skill set or how I wanted to apply my practice was different, and B, that I was interested in pedagogy. And I suppose it's because my initial assumption on my view to industrial design was that it was very focused on profit-led or creating products that people need or things. And it was only when I started to explore in my final project how design can make a contribution to the assisted dying debate, and the mentor that I had at the time, Professor Lorraine Gammon, who I now work with, that I actually started to realize that these skills or the skills, processes, methods that we have as designers can actually be applied to not just profit-led or profit logic, but actually more than profit, or how we can actually approach looking at social issues. But I also realized there was a bit of a gap in the teaching or the kind of curriculum that I was exposed to, because most of my tutors, they were great, but they came from a kind of school of thought, or ultimately, I suppose, an approach about profit logic, being true and honest. And I think my teaching at the moment, the way I'm really interested in curriculum design and how we can actually design curriculum to expose or facilitate students, not just to look at, you know, profit logic or designing for profit, but also how they can actually apply their skills to looking at social problems and making the world, for that word, a better place. And that's where I am at the moment, I'd say.
Okay. I meant to actually introduce you. Sorry, I'm slightly new to the moderating. I was like, Pras and I have had a lot of conversations about this stuff. And I think right there, that little turn about how do we rethink how we teach so that it actually leads students to applying things in a different way overlaps a lot with what both Ramon and Lisa are doing as well. That's super interesting. And you're currently teaching here in Berlin at the Code University, right? You're now a tutor at Central St. Martin's.
Yeah, I'm doing more research work over at Central St. Martin's in UAL as part of an Erasmus Plus project, where we're looking at the project's actually called Design Futures Literacy. So it's trying to develop the language and the tools and methods that students, as well as educators or facilitators, can use to actually design for futures and preferable futures. But the work here that I'm doing is at Code University, which is a tech-based university. And I think, Emily, the conversations we've had recently, and Lisa as well, but at the moment, I think the context of tech, especially in what's happened with COVID, the issues of privacy, data bias, ethics, the lot, I think it's quite timely that students can be exposed not just to that notion of, you know, making money, but also how can you actually apply that skills to make the world a better place and imagine what that better place could be like.
Good thing we've got, you know, 20 minutes to work all of this out. Ramon. So Ramon, Ramon, if you want to make yourself be seen, Ramon Tejada is here with us at RISD. And we just met briefly last summer, and you created this decolonizing, puncturing, expanding, de-Westernizing design meter, which I immediately have consumed and passed on. It's pretty remarkable. And we just started to have this conversation. It's kind of from you where I've gotten this question. Why do we teach, and why do we teach the way that we teach? And I think it's, yeah, maybe you can start off a little bit with that question.
So, hi, everyone. Hello from sunny Providence in social isolation land. It's fun to see a lot of people, and some people who are in Providence, a mile away from my house right now. I think it's really interesting, and I actually liked, Emily, your setting up a few minutes ago when you gave that little brief presentation sort of like about where this comes for you. And, you know, I was a first generation student, meaning I was the first one in my family to go to college, more or less even think of going to grad school, and I've done it twice. And I think I went to liberal arts college, and I did design and education out after college. I've always been interested in teaching, but thinking of teaching as sharing. I've always loved to collaborate. I used to be in theater before being in design, and theater is a very collaborative place to be in. You can't get anything done in theater if you don't know how to collaborate in an efficient and an honest way. So I really always liked that. I've always been interested in sharing with students, sharing with teachers. But one of the things that happened, I think, what's really, really interesting for me is I had to make a shift, and it actually occurred. The way that I teach now is very different from the way I taught before the 2016 elections here in the United States. As a lot of you know, I had a really, really physically horrid reaction to that the next day, and I had to go teach at Pratt, and I couldn't teach for a whole week. And I sort of had to make a shift in thinking about how was I teaching? What was I teaching? Who was I teaching? And really thinking about the fact that when I went through schooling, particularly the design education, and I had really great teachers, I just never saw myself. I never saw myself in any pictures, in any examples, in anything. The history, which I'm not a historian, for the record, some people, I like to punch history a lot. I actually like history a lot, but it's a really problematic field. It's always been, it's very specific to one particular point of view, the writer. But I've been really interested in sort of like, how do I get out of that mode of teaching a history, a structure, systems of design that just perpetuate the same point of view. And I think that's really challenging because a lot of us have been taught that this is the way. And I think right now we have an amazing moment to actually pivot and shift, and we have to pivot and shift really quickly. And some of us have been talking about this for the last few years. So it's really exciting to see it. But I think it's who we give space to. Emily and I were talking earlier this week, the idea of who we invite, which is an idea that I encountered through the work of Susan Yehuda and Kellen Willard of BFA, MFA, PhD, in their book, Making and Being, in a workshop that they did with us here. I think the idea of who we invite into these spaces, who is seen, who students see, I mean, we really are interested in having diverse, inclusive cultures, communities. We just can't pretend to just do that outside of the context of teaching design or engaging with design. Like, design can't just continue to be this like monolithic thing that like ascribes to this tradition, which actually is it's a very sort of conservative idea. So just that sort of frame how I'm teaching and what I'm trying to do. I'm not sure that I'm always successful at it, but I'm trying.
You know, all three of you talked a little bit about this question of sharing, you know, in terms of, and I think for many of us, we're experiencing this moment in education where previous to here and now, it was actually really hard to know what others were doing.
Right.
And now we're in a position where things are being opened up pretty radically. And, you know, maybe you guys, if, you know, I'm going to let you guys sort of jump in. You know, what does it take to share? Why, you know, why are we not sharing? Why are we sharing now? What is, you know, what's at stake with sharing? Like, why is this so hard?
Well, I'm going to jump in. I think that part of it is if you're academics, academia has always been a very resistant field towards people actually sharing. We're taking structures that are from like traditional academia where, you know, the idea of tenured or job security means that you have to publish a particular perspective, right? Like, and a lot of us are designers, so we don't come from that world. It's interesting that a lot of us teach and probably, I mean, maybe this is a generality, most of us have never really taken an education class, right? Like,
I think Pras is our certified pedagogue in the house.
Pras probably has a lot more, like, this is how you teach. A lot of us are just creative people who are really interested in engaging with students or engaging with each other. I'm having this discussion, so we sort of like learn by fire. But I think in the traditional structure of the academia, you just don't share because that's your livelihood and that's how you get your name out there and that's how you secure that job. Whereas, you know, I think now open the floodgates, everyone. I mean, a lot of us in the last few years have been sharing. I mean,
but do you also include designers as like, do you mean academia as in, sorry, just a word question. Like as in like scientists, or do you also include designers? Because the way I was educated in design is like putting your elbows out and also it's not very collaboration focused. Mm-hmm. So I think it is all about like securing your own idea and bringing that out or publishing it as a single author, for example.
Right.
So I think
what is that? Both feel. I mean, I think you place in traditional academia and in certain fields, certainly design has been, that's how we get our 15 minutes of fame, you know?
Well, I think this is related to some of what Lisa and Pras are doing in that a lot of the teaching is being done by people who are not securely rooted in academia, right? Mm-hmm. You know, external lecturers, we have a lot of people who are guest lecturers who come in and do workshops, you know, and in a sense, you know, where's the sharing? I mean, I think Lisa, you're really interested in particular sort of looking at what are all the other people doing, right? Like this platform, maybe you can add that, you know, right now in the German context in particular, where is it that we're being vulnerable with each other or not?
I'm not sure if I understand the question. Do you mean, sorry.
Well, I think there's something about sharing, you know, if you're professors, it's a different, there's different turf as somebody just mentioned, but if you are coming in as an adjunct or an external lecturer or doing workshops or facilitating workshops, there's a different kind of sharing that's possible. I think the platform that you've put together, you know, starts to move outside of the mainstream.
But I think it's also about, I mean, I wouldn't necessarily make such a big like difference maybe between what kind of position you have. I think it's about a sensibility for referencing. So I thought about our conversation a lot where we're speaking about like taking ideas from other people. And if you develop a whole curriculum then and you tell someone about it and the person uses it, then it's your work that's been used for free. And as a designer, also our ideas are our livelihood. And it's the same with education, essentially, or basically. But I would say that it's a question of transparency and referencing. So if you're using an idea, ask the person if it's okay to use it, and ask the person if he, she, or they, them want to be involved in doing something together and not just take it and appropriate it, make it your own. I think that's a huge shift. And then it doesn't even matter anymore if, yeah.
Lisa, do you think it's a broader topic around ethics and around ethical practice? Because I was just thinking also, you know, like I'd say maybe more of a Western ideology is that notion of IPR, and that is our livelihood, right? Like we have kind of intellectual property rights over ideas and things we come up with, whereas other schools of thought are far more collaborative and open.
Yeah.
Or that around that notion of sharing. And I think that does obviously bleed into the academic environment as well, especially if you have people from industry coming in, you're kind of used to that and potentially the heroes narrative. So I don't know how, I think, you know, collaborative design,
I mean, it's an illusion. I would say that it's a total illusion that any idea is not collaborative, in my opinion.
Yeah, so absolutely. I think that we're also, again, you know, like one of the things that I've been doing recently is sort of rethinking some of this language and I'm unpacking it a little bit, right? Like the word collaboration, like, again, what do we mean by collaboration? We have to reexamine that, right? Because in certain circles, collaboration really means that you exploit me because I have a certain skill set, and then you just take it and you don't even give me credit for, right? So unpacking what do we mean by collaboration, I use the term open source, and realizing that I don't have to be perfect, that I can be vulnerable, that I can be bumpy, to paraphrase Prem, like I can be bumpy, that I don't have to be perfect, which is also something that in a lot of our cultures and societies, and Western, in particular Western society, the idea of not being perfect and not being and being secure, even if you're completely insecure about what you're talking about, what you're saying, is viewed as a weakness. So thinking about, like, you know, the fact that the idea of sharing something that is not finished, that is not totally bracketed by you. It's something that I think that we need to move forward towards. I mean, I totally agree with Lisa. Like all these ideas, like none of us in many ways is like that, that idea of like, there's only three stories in the world and everybody's just riffing on them, right? Like there's nobody's coming up with anything new, right? But it's just a matter of intention and thinking about like, how do you reference, how do you invite somebody in? How do you give them credit? How do you reference them? How do you open up and make space for others? To talk and present their ideas, or even you say, this is not my idea, I just need to have them here to say it, and I'm gonna use this platform.
I'm gonna jump in really quickly, because as far as unfinished is concerned, of course this is the talk show with limited conversations, but what I think is interesting about this unfinished, and maybe we can just sort of end with this, that maybe each of you guys have a little bit of thought you know, about the moment that we're in. And it might be in context of design teaching or the design as a field, or maybe in a bigger question, you know, kind of like where I think my students are asking for it. They want to know what's happening, what's next, what does this mean? Which gives us a lot of opportunity. Those would be my last little thoughts. So maybe each of you could just sort of pipe in for just a short second and leave us with some thoughts, and then we'll open it up for about 5 minutes to the crowd. Pras, you want to?
Sure. I mean, as I said to you before, Emily, I think it's a very interesting opportunity for design. And there are so many massive questions. I mean, I just read today that Amazon, you know, the assumption is, okay, like, oh, climate change can be addressed because we're not moving around, like we're maybe not consuming as much. And then Amazon are going to post like record profits in the last quarter. So we still have this kind of consumptive ideology, which needs to shift. And that has a massive impact, I think, on us as design and where we kind of position the industry, as it were, or where we move forward. And I think, I don't know, my experience has been really around collaborative design. And I do think ethics play a massive role in where we're at the moment, whether it be how we kind of share teaching, but also ethics in terms of data on the broader set and what we're willing to kind of relinquish. And that term relinquish, or, you know, how we shift the goalposts for ourselves for the betterment of everybody else. And I know before, when I was saying designing for a better society, it sounds really lofty, But ultimately, we have to do that. We've realized that, you know, this COVID-19 is not attacked kind of one group of people, it's everyone. So how do we actually collaborate and share knowledge on that together in order to ensure that we can move forward?
Lisa, do you have a thought, last thoughts? It feels so under pressure. It's a start. This is the start of a good conversation.
So I would say, so I'm a bit torn. So the danger for me is that for the sake of like taking this opportunity now to innovate and be super productive and use this new fidgetality and whatever to that we forget the what was before and try to invent the world new without having solved the unjust structures. Mm-hmm. So my goal would be to imagine some sort of hybrid that would take what we have to what we need to learn from and then build on that the possibility that we have now to reflect on with a little bit more time. Yeah. So I don't know. I'm
that
not
rush
sure.
is real. Yeah, that rush is really yeah. real. Everything's yeah. happening so quickly and it's yeah. as yeah. we're all so excited. Ramon, you want to take us home?
I'll try to take us home. I thinking about the idea of this normal, I'm thinking about a post that I saw on Instagram that I think I posted on the chat was like, in the rush to return to normal, use this time to consider which parts of normal are worth rushing back to, or what do we carry forward? But also thinking about a thought that I've been having is like whether what we call design is an antiquated idea and we need to come up with a new language for it, because maybe when we say design, we immediately catalog it in this box and in this baggage of 20th century, all of yeah. that stuff, all the bad habits. I'm thinking about design engaging in conversations and dialogue and not talking at people, because we're experts and we know how to organize your thought into like coherent, beautiful stuff, but thinking about how we actually leave spaces for people to engage with us and let them talk. So
it's a lovely sentiment.
Does that bring it back home?
Thank you. So if we've got people in the audience that would like to kind of poke at us for a couple minutes, about 5 minutes, that Woo! Would be lovely. Please write something. Iman, hi. Why does it have to be a question of opportunity? Can design ever exist outside the rush of solutionism? This is the greatest opportunity. Now is the moment. Would anybody like to try to Ooh. Take a stab at that? I like this concept of solutionism as well.
I think that's the mother of questions, actually. Can design ever exist outside the rush of solutionism? I think we will have to define that now. In the future, yeah. mm-hmm. even more. Like, what is
it? Lisa, do you think as surely as we acknowledge that the design process is about iteration? So by its very nature, it's not necessarily that it comes to an end point, but that we are reevaluating, right? And it's a yeah. wicked problem. It means that we can't solve it. It's things that they need to be continually addressed and
Yeah, but as it is now, it doesn't make sense anymore. To me, at least. So... Mm-hmm. For me, it's clear that that something's like changing for real now, for me at least. But
yeah, I guess I would also add to that. It's like I resist the temptation of finishing things, right? Mm. Or that we have absolute ideas, right? And also, I mean, but this is also a question related to professional fields or professional practice, which Dick has a different kind of structure sometimes, I think, than what a lot of the times a lot of us are working in different models. And it's the challenge of trying to get that world, which has so much power and control and finances and everything, to sort of shift along with us.
One of the things I'm going to sort of throw in here, actually, there is something that I think has been interesting that we've all talked about, because I think most of us, at least the three of us, are in the mode of remote. And what are the, you know, what are the things that are perhaps problematic or urgent or maybe even optimistic around, you know, once we move into remote, perhaps, you know, just from the battlefield of sort of jumping in. Maybe you guys have a little bit of insight to share.
I mean, my question, interesting how it evolves, especially working in, I suppose, more creative practice where students, if it's either product, industrial, whichever ceramic design, they're really used to kind of making in a physical space. Mm-hmm. How do we kind of facilitate that in the digital realm? Yeah, of course, discussion and breakout rooms we can have, but when you're actually making, it's a different dynamic, and you obviously require kind of the environment and being in that workshop structure, so, or studio. And I'm interested in as to how that evolves, but also there are many question marks I have over that.
But isn't that also thinking, I mean, that we have, again, sort of dictated that this field requires this kind of thing, which is actually really privileged. Not a, a lot of people have studios. I mean, absolutely. A lot of you, I would argue, from seeing pictures of all of your stuff throughout social media, some of us have lived like a desk by a window, and that's our studio. So like predicating that the education requires all of this machinery, all of this equipment, maybe pigeonholes us into making certain things, but maybe this is the moment to let go of that and be like, ooh, let's reexamine. What is it that we make? Maybe we need to make less stuff. Like,
absolutely. But then going back to it, then that's an institutional question, right? How do you then suddenly have degree programs that are predicated on making physical objects suddenly end? And it's a question how this evolves.
Absolutely. But maybe you make with what you have, right? Like maybe you really think that, you know, like back to DIY for real, and get into a critical discussion with what DIY is, what, you know, like with, make with what you have and think what you need. Right now, I think a lot of us are thinking, what do we really need right now? Like, what do you need in isolation when you're by yourself or you're with your partner or maybe your dog or maybe your kids? Like, what are the basis, the basic things we need to survive and sustain a living, right?
Do you not also think that equally this, what this has showed us is, yeah, globalization, fab, but something like this brings it to its knees. And if you actually have things like local production, you know, it, maybe it's a shout for that, that we actually move to a more local open design and manufacture on a local level.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I'm going to have to slightly wrap us up. I think we'll actually have to wrap us up because we've got a script. But I'm hoping that some of this opens it up. I mean, there's a couple of other questions in the chat, and I'd be happy to sort of continue this conversation, especially how to do things at a at an institutional level and how to think about, you know, sort of solutions or ways of thinking through this. And I'm personally really kind of pulled by this question of vulnerability and unfinishedness. Mm-hmm. It almost feels like a perspective or position that can sort of shift us as teachers, but also as students or as practitioners. It's pretty optimistic, but I'm hoping that takes us somewhere. All right, then I can do this and I get to go back to Prem.
Okay. Well, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Definitely a conversation to be continued. Thank you, Lisa. Thank you, Pras. Thanks. Thank you, Ramon.
Thank you,
Emily, for bringing everyone together. There are some great questions in the chat too, and so hopefully there'll be other opportunities to continue to reflect on them. In the meantime, I did want to think about, I mean, teaching is important, and, you know, we've all been learning things our entire lives, and this question of vulnerability seems really key. Are you muted, Emily, by any chance?
I am muted.
Okay, all right. What I wanted to say is vulnerability is really important. And I think next week we'll have a couple of guests who will also touch on vulnerability, in particular in relationship to the act of karaoke. Karaoke is one of the cornerstones of our Sunday program because it requires, it's not about skill, it's about getting in front of everybody and being willing to be vulnerable. And so actually, I wanna ask, I should have kept Lisa and Pras and Ramon on, if any of you feel like joining, I'd like to ask, Hudia, can you unmute everybody? And if people feel like it, you can join in to a karaoke tune.
So we remember them in our thoughts and prayers. But on this Sunday, to the bottom of my heart, and on behalf of the world.
You learn, girl, never ever knew before.
Watching those two mates fall.
Now I'm a rebel. Oh, that left ear.
Ask everyone to unmute, to mute yourself again. We've got weird background.
You muted yourself.
Sorry, I was going to say, it is my dream that everybody in the world might one day sing karaoke together, all of us out of tune. That's where we're trying to go with this. But yeah, so we're gonna continue now, or Emily, did you?
Hey, yeah, Prem, I don't know if I'm done yet. I still have some things I need to talk about. Is that okay? I mean, my issue is that we were talking about that we teach the way we were taught, and there's actually, I mean, I had a pretty remarkable education growing up. In particularly, I went to this experimental alternative school in Salt Lake City, and my elementary school teacher is here, and I would love to talk to her for just a moment about, you know, what does it mean to start a school? I mean, here's somebody who started a school. Is that okay in your timetable? I mean, it's like 3-4 minutes maybe. I can do this. Mom, are you here?
I am.
Hi, Mom. Everybody, this is my mom, Judy Ferry Smith, calling in from Utah. Hi, Mom.
Hi, daughter.
Hi. So we've, I mean, I think I have given presentations more than once where I talk about the open classroom And I think those of you here, we can see this is actually a picture of the uninterrupted, sustained, silent reading center at the open classroom as I was growing up. We called it USSR. And I realized that in all these years, you've given me books, you've given me papers, you've given me documentation, but we've never had so much of a conversation. So I'm actually really curious to talk to you just for a moment about what does it mean to start a school and where were you at that you decided to sort of take an incredible, huge risk and commitment and start a new school?
Gosh, well, it was when you were a baby, actually, and your brother and sister were in elementary school. And we were newly arrived in Utah from Boston and suffering some culture shock, to say the least. This was in 1970. And I was looking how, well, I went back to get a degree in special education. And in the process of that, I really decided that all education should be individualized to the degree that special education was. And I found a tiny school in a church that had about 30 students from kindergarten through sixth grade. And I was so excited about what they were doing that I moved your brother and sister out of the traditional elementary schools into that school and ended up teaching there myself. That school was in a church and it quickly grew too big for the church, like about 50 students, and then it went to another church and then it went to a building, and we were tired of moving around. So when you were probably in kindergarten or so, we went to the district offices and said, would they support an alternative school in their system? It really was a charter school, way before charter schools were even thought of. And this very progressive superintendent said, sure, find 60 kids and we'll give you space. We'll give you whatever we give any other teacher in the school, except for transportation. We had to provide our own transportation. So we had a public meeting and 120 people signed up to have their kids be part of this school. And that was the beginning of the open classroom. And the picture you have behind you is a wonderful reminder of what that was like. But we talked and thought a lot about what we were doing and why we were doing it. And I've been in education, well, I'm retired now, the rest of my life. And that's what I always ask teachers to do. Think about what they're doing, why they're doing it, what's working, what's not working, and be willing to change on a momentary notice if that's true. So anyway, so here we were with all these kids and a cadre of totally devoted teachers. And we began to see that certain things were necessary in order to have us reach our goals. Do you want to ask questions or you want me just talk?
You can just talk. I can absorb this.
Okay. Anyway, one was that we had to use the whole community. So parents and grandparents, brothers and sisters were all part of our school. In fact, they were required to be a part of it in some way. And so we had a community of teachers and learners. That's the other thing, we considered ourselves both, all of us were both teachers and learners. So kids were teaching each other. I was learning from kids. I was learning from the parent who was a mathematician who, you know, had some ideas about what he thought should happen and so forth and so on. So we used the whole community in terms of reaching, in order to reach our goals. We always had four or five adults in the room at any time, working individually or in small groups with kids. The other thing is we collaborated. We were just talking about collaboration earlier, and you know, I probably got as much information from kids about what they needed as I did from their parents, or I thought I knew myself. So there was a heavy emphasis on collaboration, and in the process, you know, we had this vibrant, exhausting community. It was a labor of love because the meetings went on forever.
Yes.
And
you said I spent my childhood underneath the table every night at the school.
4 and 5 years old. Yeah. The teacher meetings went on for hours, and Emily and her friends would play under the table, games and the like. So you were well versed in it. But the things that started that school, and that school is still in existence here in Salt Lake. It actually goes through middle school now. And that's more than 45 years. So it's an amazing experiment. And it still feels a little bit the same way. It's somewhat more structured. In the 70s, being structured was not a...
I mean, it's not such a radical concept, at least from a German perspective, where I'm engaging in sort of, you know, more alternative schools in Berlin. But I mean, in the 70s, you know, were there platforms or resources that you guys had? You know, were there, you know, what were you able to sort of base some of the ideas from? Or was it primarily sort of what everybody brought to the table?
Well, we all read Summerhill, which was a story of a school in London, which was a totally free school. And we picked and chose from that document, and their experience is what we thought we wanted to do. And I also have to say that in many ways, Chuck reminded, Emily's dad reminded me of this. We were Bostonians, newly in Salt Lake City, and we're in a bit of a culture shock, especially in the school systems, which were extensions of the Mormon church, frankly, at that point. I think they're better now. So in many ways, I probably have to admit that was a reaction to being in a Mormon-based school and wanting something more liberal and progressive for my kids.
I think sometimes there's this argument, or I think this, of having lived in LA or having lived in different places, that the more extreme something is here, the easier it is to actually really differentiate and yeah, make something that's at the other. I just want to say, Mom, I really appreciate, for a while, I think I had to work out the fact that my mom was my teacher for so long. But I think now as a full-grown educator and adult, that the education that you introduced, I think, to my life pretty much informs almost all of the teaching I do. It's sort of really from the get-go. So I really appreciate you joining us today.
Needless to say, I'm thrilled. And I'm always thrilled to hear you talk about what you're doing and relate back to the experiences you had as a kid. Yes. That's very gratifying. Yes. So thank you.
Okay, stay safe, Mom. Stay with us, but we'll jump back. So Prem, you can have your show back now.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much, Judy. It is a pleasure to have my mother-in-law on the show and be able to learn something from her every time. One of the things that was so interesting about what Judy just said was also the idea that the reaction to the context or the reaction to something else can spark action. That came up a little bit in what Lisa talked about before. It came up in Pras's conversation as well. And I think that that's an interesting idea. So I'm gonna bring us to the last part of our show, which is, for those of you who have been here a couple weeks, you've come to know Connie Samaras, an artist based in Los Angeles, who has worked across media in a conceptual vein for a long time. And I credit Connie with having introduced me and really seeded in me the idea of the work of the science fiction author, Octavia Butler. And so Connie is joining us from Los Angeles for a recurring segment around Octavia Butler. And so, Connie, I'm going to ask you to come and join us on stage.
Okay, I'm here.
How are you doing? It's early still.
I'm awake. I drank a lot of coffee. That was such a great conversation. Thank you, Emily, for organizing that. And
it was actually Prem's recommendation. I had to ask my mom, and
thank
was
you both.
Thrilled that she joined.
But everybody.
Everybody should always have their mothers on shows. This is perfect.
Mine would be a ghost, but yes.
The truth.
So Prem, do you still want to read, or should we leave more time for...
Why don't we do a shorter reading, and then I'll start to pull up my screen. We could do a shorter reading, and then break out
into
the groups.
I'm going to do a super short reading, but you start. You have that beautiful reading voice. Then I'll do a short reading.
Whoa, that was not unexpected. Sorry. I think that there's just karaoke running in the background infinitely.
Yeah, I can't sing to Barry Gordy there.
Well, I mean, the good thing of the whole point of karaoke is that nobody can really do it. Let me try to get, just for those of you who may have been joining for the first times here, Connie, for what? For the last 25 years, really, you've been seeding Octavia Butler's Parable of the Sower and kind of distributing it to people, incorporating into your work in multiple ways. And so we're continuing that here today. Is that fair?
Yeah. Yeah. It was published in 1993, but all her writings are amazing. And but this, the parable series are a cautionary tale that actually predict the end point of neoliberalism in the United States, which, as people know, it's quite dire here because of Trump, and we have no national testing. And I was jealous to hear that Germany's opening up, but it's a mess here. But anyway, yes, great book.
Yeah, no, and I mean, at your prompt, I've been rereading it week by week with this program. It's been fantastic. So what we thought we would do today is start with a short reading from Parable of the Sower, and Julia will also put into the chat. We've been distributing scans of the chapters of Parable of the Sower each week by week, and so Julia will put the chapters that Connie has scanned for us there. Does this look good, Connie, in terms of, it's hard to read, isn't it? Give me a second.
What we could do is just each read a verse and then go to the dream section, because I'm worried people won't have enough time.
Fair enough. So why don't we just read, can I read that section at the end of page 24?
Yeah, you read that. Yes, please do.
Okay. So once again, just as a little bit of a background, the book's protagonist, Lauren Oya Olamina, who is 15 or 16, she is living in a kind of walled community. Her father himself is a preacher, and she has been developing her own religion in a way, in the midst of a near future, 2024, that is extremely precarious. So let me just read a little bit from this. For whatever it's worth, here's what I believe. It took me a lot of time to understand it, then a lot more time with the dictionary and a thesaurus to say it just right, just the way it has to be. In the past year, it's gone through 25 or 30 lumpy, incoherent rewrites. This is the right one, the true one. This is the one I keep coming back to. God is power. Infinite, irresistible, inexorable, indifferent. And yet, God is pliable. Trickster, teacher, chaos, clay. God exists to be shaped. God is change. This is the literal truth. So do you want to continue on this page, Connie, or the next page?
Well, you know what I'm going to do?
Yeah.
I thought I would just skip to the, although you don't have it up there, to the three lines that start chapter 6, which we...
I have that. I can pull it up.
Okay. It's very short. And it's important to note that Octavia Butler is African American. Chapter 6, yeah, not 7, 6.
There.
So I read this in, because a lot of people now are demonstrating in the US to open up prematurely. Drowning people sometimes die fighting their rescuers. So I'll leave it at that.
Thank you.
We talked about, do you want to, we talked
sure.
about last week, next week, as Prem talked about, we're going to have Dr. George Bermudez, who's here in Los Angeles. He's a psychoanalyst who's done a lot of work on social justice, and he's really pioneering reanimating this field called social dreaming, which looks at our dreams not as my dream or your dream, but our dream, and reflecting a social unconscious. And And we talked last week again about the idea of bumpiness and certainty as being a place where that seeds creativity and difference, yet at the same time, it also is where trauma resides. So thinking about the trauma over the pandemic, climate breakdown, all these things that are hard, difficult to talk about, that almost creates an aphasia. Where do we process that through our unconscious? And one of the areas are dreams. So Prem had this idea for us to do these breakout groups, and we talked with George, and George does these guided social dreaming matrices, and there should be two articles from last week that George gave us that if people want to read more, and he'll talk about it more next week. So we're doing a very crude version of this, where we're going to break out into groups and then come back, and those of you who feel comfortable can write it into your dreams into the chat. And again, to think about these as our dreams and reflecting history coursing through us. And then next week, George will talk more about social dreaming, and then he'll also look at the chat and make some connections between the dreams. So do you want to add anything before?
Sure. Sure. So, and so just a couple of, to just build on what Connie said, it's an experiment. And as she said, Dr. George Bermudez, he does this as a much longer scale thing. And once he introduces this social dreaming matrix, it may be something that some of you would like to take part in. For yes. Now, what we're going to do is a very short, about 12-minute breakout group. For those of you who aren't familiar with that, I will open the rooms and you'll be put randomly with a group of maybe 5 or 6 other people. And let's treat this as hopefully it's comfortable. You know, it's an experiment as well, but the idea is that this is a space to share. If any of you have been having dreams or things that you want to share in that group, one of the things that's that George had mentioned to Connie and me is that in his social dreaming, these dreams are not ascribed to individuals. So it's not even who has the dream, but what is the dream? And let's, as a thought experiment, try to treat other people's dreams as if they're our own. Rather than trying to interpret them or make hypotheses about them, it's okay to associate with them, but treat them as almost a collective dream. And hopefully we can have a short discussion about that and then come back and everybody can take a moment and share whatever they feel comfortable. I'll also say breakout rooms in Zoom are not recorded in any way. So they're totally, you know, you all can do what you want. And if you don't feel comfortable, you'll get a prompt that'll ask you to go into the breakout room. And then at the end, one to bring you back to the main room. If you don't feel comfortable, stay in the main room and, you know, just hang out, take a break for 10 minutes, make a coffee, and then come back and we'll continue and end today's session.
So just a couple of guidelines that George had, as Prem mentions, is that you begin that, like, you don't say, who's got the first dream? You go, what is the first dream? And that one of the things that happens, and I know it's so short a time, is that you should go into kind of a state of reverie and just start to free associate. So it doesn't matter what the dream is or if it's seemingly related. And as Prem said, please resist interpreting anybody's dreams from or focusing on the individual dreamer. You're just associating. And then it's a collective dialogue, but again, I just wanna point out that this is different from like a Jungian idea of a collective unconscious being based on a series of archetypes. This is much more of thinking of a social unconscious from a point of diversity as well. So, but that's it.
So let's try that. Okay. And as always, I think the generals, and I think so many of us are teachers or have been students, let's just all listen to each other and be respectful and see what comes out of it. And we'll join back here in about 10 or 11 minutes.
Okay.
Okay.
Thanks, Prem.
Great. I'm going to do it. You'll get a prompt to enter the room. Okay. Should get an invitation and then... Did you get an invitation, Emily?
Yeah, I'll get it. I've got my people.
Okay.
Hi, Eric.
Hey, hello. Julia, how are you?
How are you?
Good, good.
I think we need a beer, something to chat.
Yeah.
Mishma, can you hear us?
Where are you, Christopher?
I'm in Dubai.
In Dubai, wow.
Yeah.
I am in Berlin. Eric, oh. I think he's in New York.
Yep.
Michelle,
nice to meet you all. Hi. I'm in New York too.
Cool. Lauren? Hi.
Hello, I'm in Mexico City. It's nice to meet you all.
¿Hablas español?
No, un poco.
Ah, qué gracioso. Okay, well, we should speak in English, so. it was a try. So, what about your dreams? Are you dreaming? Do you remember?
Oh, sure.
I mean, I can go first. Like, personally, like, since being locked in for like 2 months, I rarely, I mean, I guess I have the dreams, I just don't remember them. And the ones that I do have are kind of like the tropes of being stuck back in school, having like multiple jobs that I used to hold that I apparently never quit, and having the anxiety of, you know, not finishing the test, not completing the job, never leaving, and trying to juggle those things and make decisions about my life that I made like 10 years ago that were already resolved and for some reason continue to be unresolved. That's kind of the through line on the ones that I do have and do remember now. But for me, it's been just like kind of, nighttime is just darkness now.
Laura, do you want to share something?
Sure, I can share that last night I've been dreaming a lot, very extensive, multi-stage dreams. Two things that stood out from my dream last night, which is like, my mother, who has passed, has been appearing in my dreams quite a bit lately. And last night, she was there, and my dad, and they were in a home, not anywhere where I grew up or that they ever lived. And there were several plants that she was kind of had around, and beautiful glass vases, small. And I was trying to sort out which of the plants I could take clippings from to put in these vases. Another part was that their bedroom, they had put like a makeshift kitchen into their bedroom. And it was on top of a set of shelves or furniture, but the furniture was incredibly unstable. So it was just like, you touch it and it would just kind of rock back and forth. And I was like, what's going on? But then part of the makeshift kitchen, which really stood out, was that it was just full. It was just a huge stack of these very thick paper plates and a microwave. And that's very important, like symbolically, right? I was just like, oh, what's going on with my parents? They'll never evolve. So much trash and the food, you know. And I felt like there was maybe one other very sick, oh yes, another part of the dream, you know, which I find all this so fascinating based on this idea of social dreaming, is like that aspect of like this, the waste. But then there's another part of the dream where my brother-in-law, he and my sister have been married for almost 30 years, just kind of silently, without addressing anything, started to shift his expression of himself and started wearing, like, at a family dinner in the dream, just like was wearing really short, like feminine shorts. And then later on had changed into like really flowy pants, and just his whole demeanor had changed. And it was clear that, I mean, in the dream, I was thinking like, oh, that's so interesting. Like, Evan hasn't addressed this at all. Like, I wonder how long he's thought about this, or, you know, so those are the things that came up in my dream last night.
Wow. A lot of information.
Yeah.
I'm really impressed with your ability to recall all that and also tell it to us. So
Well, thank you. I've been really practicing on, we share our dreams in the mornings. Whenever I wake up and I can remember it, I'm speaking about it because they're so, seem so other, you know, it's just this whole other world.
It is, I think.
Yeah.
Oh, it's another layer. I don't know.
Yes. In.
Both. I don't know. I don't remember. My thing is that since the last like 4 weeks, I know that I have very deep dreams, and while I'm sleeping, I'm thinking that okay, I don't want to forget that, and then I forgot. When I wake up, maybe because I smoke before going to bed, I don't know, but this is something that sometimes it's not working. Sometimes I need to smoke before going to bed because it's a lot of info going on, yeah. And I can sleep, but I don't remember. It's a shame, yeah. Shade, we say here. Yeah, and Michelle, do you remember something of Christopher?
I usually normally have very vivid dreams, but lately I have not had dreams that I tend to remember. I just think like my brains go overloaded with information, work and teaching part-time, that the few dreams I remember just don't seem to make much sense to me. Where people come in my house and they want to stay, mm-hmm. and they want to disrupt us while we're in bed. So one dream I ended up kicking the guy out and saying you could go into our back bedroom and sleep. But every 5 minutes he kept getting up and wanting to ask us questions. So that's probably one I remember the most. But other dreams, I don't remember because I have a tendency to talk. Have full conversations in my dreams. Really, I do. I really will sit up in bed and start talking and have these full conversations. And my partner, he'll tell me, oh yeah, you know, you were really going at it last night. And I was like, yeah, okay. But I haven't been doing that lately. I can't speak like for where everybody else is, except for like Eric's here in New York. So it's like, I don't know, there's like this eerie silence. And I don't know if it's like, because, you know, there's not a lot of noise, except for like hospital sirens that I'm hearing a lot. But when I go up on the roof of my house, it's just like really quiet. I don't hear traffic or anything. So maybe it's the silence that has really quieted my mind and my thinking more than usual.
Yeah, that's a good point. Like where I am, like I'm right under the BQE, which is like a major highway in New York. And yeah. Like it's normally just like our apartment is like super loud, vibrating all night. And it's just been dead silence lately. And it's been such a weird adjustment. Like I hated that when I first moved in, but now it's kind of disrupting my sleep, the silence actually.
Yeah, I'm five blocks from from Harlem Hospital.
The sirens are crazy.
Yeah, really, really all the time. I start to think of like Stephen King's The Stand at one point with all the sirens.
Yeah.
Did we hear from Christopher? Did you have dream time?
I guess quickly, yeah, I haven't had the ability to remember anything, I think, now, except for twice in this quarantine time. I've had this dream where I had this sensation of having to vomit, and then I woke up thinking that I vomited all over myself.
Wow.
Taste of vomit in my mouth, and then, like, rushing to the bathroom, thinking I have to, like, fix something, but then it was just, like, in my imagination, and this happened twice, I guess, in the past month, and I haven't experienced it before, but definitely very powerful feeling. It's like when you are dreaming and you think you peed on yourself or something, but worse.
More now.
And I guess I'll leave you with that.
Thank you for sharing. Okay.
Looks like we're returning.
Yeah.
Okay, people are rejoining. Well, I want to just ask you, I just take a moment while people are rejoining, just take a moment to yourself to think. And I don't know how the breakout rooms were, may have been a little short, but take a moment and think if there's anything you want to add into the chat, either something from a dream that you've had or that somebody mentioned, that maybe also Dr. George Bermudez, when he's here next week, can consider, or something that came out of the group, your impressions. Just take a brief moment and then type, whether you want to type a couple of words or a couple of sentences into the chat. Okay, just to repeat for people who are just rejoining, if you can, take a brief moment and just close your eyes and think of whatever comes to mind from the breakout group. If there's anything you want to share of a dream that you or somebody else had, or even your impressions, just type a couple of words into the chat. That's fascinating. Thank you. Just looking at the chat, I see these visions from people, emotions, and I think so many of them resonate with me. Thank you. And vulnerability, which a couple of people have mentioned, which apparently I pronounce entirely differently from Emily. I say vulnerability. I don't know why. Apparently other people say vulnerability. But this keeps coming up, so thank you. Well, the dreams as portals. Thank you, Ramon. Yeah, I mean, I do think they're like a window. They're a window into a way to go somewhere else when maybe we can't all go somewhere else. So I want to kind of bring us down from that. I mean, in some ways, that was a precursor to what will happen next week. As Connie mentioned, we'll have Dr. George Bermudez, who will share some of his the readings of his work, how he has created these social dreaming matrices. And Connie has been working with him and known him for many years. And hearing him talk about this, I think, will be very interesting. We're also going to share with him this chat, just to see what he might also think of as a social matrix, rather than thinking about dreams as being individual in the mode of psychoanalysis. What does it mean to think of dreams as being social? So I think, you know, I thank you everyone for being here today. As we always do, we're going to close with something to get us back into our bodies and move around. But also today has been a wonderful session for me to see other people in conversation, for Emily, who is really an integral part of the show, to be able to bring some of the other educators and designers that she's in dialogue with, and also her mother here. Thank you, Judy. Thank you, Connie, as always, for leading us through Parable of the Sower. It's been really meaningful and incredible to kind of think through it in real time with you and with other people. And thank you, everyone, for coming again. Next week, we will have Same time, same place. We're going to have Connie again with Dr. George Bermudez. We'll have Kasim Nakvi, who is a percussionist and composer. We'll have the musician and curator Taja Cheek, as well as a couple of other special guests. And so I hope that you'll join us to continue to think together. As always, there is a bit.ly link that Julia can copy in, which will keep all of the information up to date, where to find us. And if you want to join our mailing list, we'll send out an email on Thursday with the full lineup. So I think if anybody else, I keep seeing things popping up in the chat, and this is fantastic. If there's any last thoughts that you have, any feelings that you have coming out of this session, also feedback, criticism, things you think we could do differently, just type them into the chat. Let's take one moment, and then I'll queue up our next song, our last song. Let's see if we can all hear this, our last song of the evening, morning for some of you. Oh, nope, sorry. It's always the tech. Let's try it one more time. No, it's nothing. Okay, one more try. Okay, here we go.
to shine its way.
Thanks, everyone. Still always that music at the end, some tech difficulties, but it's great to see you all. Thank you for coming. Have a safe week, and it's wonderful to see everyone. Thank you so much. And thanks to all of our fantastic guests as well. We'll see you next week, same time, same place, in the internet.
Bye-bye, Prem. Bye-bye, all. See you next week.
Sounds good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much,
everyone.
Have a good day.
Thank you. Have a good day.
Thanks, everyone. Thanks, Christopher. You guys are awesome. We're here all the time.
Bye.
I don't know. I guess.
Okay. Bye, Grace.
Bye, everybody.
Bye. Great show.
Okay, bye, Mom. Bye, Kina. Bye, Mom. Bye, Dad.